do so with a prayerful intent. God might give you a personal revelation, write you a personal prescription that gives you all your medicine in your room. You heard me say it before, I might well say it again. Don't be so busy that you're too busy to be a Christian.
Yeah.
It can happen. The world we live in moves mighty fast. And some of us have a lot of demands to meet each other. But somewhere along the way, you know that you need time to talk with the Master. Would you give the Lord a hand praise with you? So, the lesson today, again, is in the book of Genesis chapter 32. Would you stand with us all over the building? Everyone, everywhere, standing with us. We declare to you, this is the holy and the righteous will of God. And it reads, "And he rose up that night and took his two wives and his two women servants and his 11 sons and passed over the Jordan Valley. And he took them and sent them over the brook and sent over that he had. 24. And Jacob was left alone. And there wrestled a man with him until the breaking of the day. And when he saw that he prevailed not against him, the man that wrestled with him, he touched the hollow of Jacob's thigh. And the hollow of Jacob's thigh was out of joint as he wrestled with him. And the man said, let me go, for day breaketh. Listen to what Jacob said. And Jacob said, I will not let you go, except thou bless me. May the Lord bless him to the hearers, the readers, the most certain doers of his holy word. Would you close your eyes and bow your heads where you are, kind Father, God, great that you are. Oh, how excellent is your name in all the earth. We declare that there's none like you nowhere, Father. In this hour, our hearts are running over with gratitude for your mercy, for your kindness, for your love and grace towards us. This hour, we pray, Father, that you would beckon our attention away from every earthly distraction, that for a moment we might bask in the stillness of your presence, that your spirit might have full access to our hearts, our mind, our being. Let your word now illuminate every dark place in our life with the light of understanding and empower us to walk in your will and in your way and in your word. Allow your healing hands, Father, to find someone to touch in this house. Heal them in Jesus' name. Healing in their bodies. Healing in their minds. Healing in even their relationships. Father, when we come away from this worship experience, let us still be saturated in your presence, that the glow of the Holy Spirit be upon us. We might be able to go into the world as a light in darkness, illuminating the way back to the cross. We ask this and all other blessings in the strong name of Jesus, and all of God's people said, amen.
Amen.
Come on again, praise God.
Love.
wonderful people.
Amen.
I'm sure you have two or three good friends yourself. It's hard to find a true friend. Then we have a host of associates, you know, people that we associate around various common interests. But when the chips are down, I wish I had a witness. And when the crowd gets thin, I come to find out there's not a friend. Can I get a witness? Life changes. Come on, bless you. Greet you as Christ often greeted his disciples in the scriptures. He would greet them with the words, "Peace be unto you." Habakkuk 2:20 tells us the Lord is in his holy temple, that all the earth keeps silence before him. Brothers and sisters, we are delighted and glad to be a part of this 40 days of prayer and fasting. Just trusting God day by day. As we walk in his presence, there's something extraordinary about what the Holy Spirit can do. And I want you to begin to journal down in the journals you have. Write down some of the things you notice God doing in your life. Because later on, when you flip back to those pages a week, a month, a year from now, you're going to need that inspiration to encourage you that what God has done, he's able to do now. Bless him one more time. Is a bad person. I believe that Jacob had perhaps felt that life has simply dealt him a bad hand. And when life seemingly refused to give Jacob what he felt he deserved, he then was willing to do whatever was necessary to get what he wanted out of life. But now, life has caught up with Jacob. I don't know, that there seems to be people that seems to have, I don't know, some Midas touch or whatever. They go with like blessings and opportunities follow. But I don't think that describes everybody in here this morning. There are some folk that struggle really is your middle name. And the truth be told, you came to earth struggling. Y'all gonna pray for me? And so, oftentimes in the middle of all that you're going through, if you're not careful, you'll begin to compromise and try to just rig things, hear me now, in your favor. Rather than wait on God, we are often initiated to do things within our own power. And in the midst of that, God becomes, listen, someone that we rarely even speak with. Yeah. But now, Jacob now finds himself at the end of every scheme. Yeah. Out of tricks. Short on traps. You know, I had a whole uncle that was kind of, I don't know, feisty. Put it this way, he had twins when he was 67 years old. Y'all gonna pray with me? Died a few weeks ago, born 1918. Look, listen, still look good laying on the gas. Go crying. All kind of folks crying, believe me. And when I was born, around, I don't know, around 8, 9 o'clock, I was around Uncle Robert. He would say, "Hey, Rex, I guess I better get up and go check my traps." We'll explain that later. Some folks have been set traps, you know, manipulating folks. Yeah. Some folks know just what to say to you to get what they want out of you. And some of y'all glad they say it. So don't make him out to be a terrible person. Somebody here feel like they've been fair to you either. Someone in here feel that you worked a little harder than the folk around you. Look like the folk around you got a little farther up. Uh-huh. Listen. Now there's trouble coming for Jacob. You see, Jacob had tricked and buffaloed his older brother Esau and tricked Esau out of his rightful inheritance. Took all that his daddy Isaac had left him. Grabbed all the grip, ran out, left town. And for 20 years, he had been living high on the hog. But now God fixed it so he had to come home. And coming home meant he had to confront the one he had done wrong. The record here in chapter 32 says, Jacob sent a message over to his brother and said, "Listen, hey, you remember me, don't you? Your little brother Jacob? What's up? I'm going to be in town in a few days." Coming home, and the messenger came back and said, "What did Esau say?" He said, "He's coming to meet you, and he's bringing 400 men with him." You know, one of the hardest things for a lot of folk to do is to sincerely say, "I'm sorry." I'm serious. Some folks were backing, I don't know, 5 cakes. Fried 10 bologna sandwiches rather than tell you I'm sorry. Some folks just don't want to admit they've done others wrong. And oftentimes, the enemy will keep folks separated simply because of pride. Y'all bring it? And here God has a way to say, "Listen, I'm going to fix it so the very one you've done wrong, you got to meet." What kind of Christian are you? Can you meet the one that did you wrong and love them anyway? Oh, y'all so quiet. I told y'all, don't be mad at Jacob. Be mad at you. Can you meet the one that cost you your job? Y'all, oh, and not get your posse together and come after them. Don't matter coming to me, I'm coming to you. Listen, look at this. I want you to see. Now, we're going to have to address this today, but do your best. I want you to see something. There's an unusual prayer. So it's about 40 days of prayer. I want to show you how Jacob prayed about this. Now, listen. He says, and Jacob said, look, O God of my father, Abraham and God of my father, Isaac. He said, listen, I'm not certain you know who I am, but I know you know my daddy. You are the God of my grandfather. You're the God of my father. And I just thought I would talk with you for a moment. Church, do you know me? He said, the Lord which said unto me, return unto thy country and to thy kindred, and I will deal well with thee. See, in verse 9, Jacob begins reminding God and himself about the instructions God had given him, the promise. He said, listen, you know, God, you told me to go back home. And you told me that you would deal well with me. Now, listen to me. Verse 10. He says, then listen to what he says. And he's praying now, right? He says, God, I am not worthy of the least of all the mercies. Notice mercies is plural. There's so many things that you kept from me that should have come to me. There's so many things that I should have endured. That you held back the storm, you held back the night. He said, now I recognize that I'm not worthy of that. He goes on to say, and all your truth, the word truth in the Hebrew means your faithfulness. Right. That though I have drifted, you never let go of me. Yeah. That though I have departed, you always left the door open so I can come back in. Come on. Thou hast shown me unto thy servant. Listen, for with my staff, I passed over the Jordan. In other words, when I left home, all I had was my stick and the clothes on my back. When I ran out, I didn't have anything. But look now, he says, but now I got two bands of troops, thousands of camels, thousands of donkeys. Somebody know when you left home, all you had was a good bag. Are you with me? Listen, I'll tell the story that we grew up about 3 bedrooms in the summertime, about 14 folk. Every room was a bedroom at certain times of night. 4 or 5 of us in a room. I don't know, I think I was engaged to my cousin about 6 months. I don't know what's going on. Now, who are you? When I left home at 17, 18, if I would have gone to the Y, I would have had more privacy. So somebody know what I'm talking about. You didn't leave home with a whole lot. Oh, y'all so fine now. But look what God has blessed you with. Look what he blessed you with. Don't praise yourself still no more. He said, when I left, all I had was a staff. All I had was a clothes on my back. And the mercies you showed me, I'm not worthy of. Look at verse 11. Of all things I ask God, he didn't say, God, protect me. He didn't say, God, guard me. He didn't say, God, you know, fight my battles. He says, God, deliver me. He goes on to deliver me, I pray, from the hand of my brother, from the hand of Esau, for I fear him, lest he will come and smite. Listen, it's interesting to see that Jacob finds himself in prayer. Although Jacob had gained materially and had experienced success in other matters, God is not finished doing a work in him. Listen, there comes a time in every believer's life where you have to, listen, go through a transition. Those of you who are sensitive to the move of God and the Spirit of God, you can discern when the Lord is moving specifically in an area in your life. And I think Jacob began to sense a shifting in the spirit. That I've come as far as I can come with being the person that I've been. And maybe you and I have come as far as we can go being the person we've been. That's Hebrews chapter 13. I'm gonna get y'all. Y'all pray with me for a minute. Not gonna hold you long. Listen. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 20. It says, Paul writes, now the God of peace, the brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant. Look at 22. Make you, say you.
Yeah.
Make you perfect. That what he means is putting every joint completely in its place.
Yeah.
Otherwise, over time, some things have shifted in your life. Over time, some things have come out the joint in your life.
Yeah.
And he says, I'm praying by the blood of Jesus
yeah.
that he will put everything back completely
yeah.
in his divine order. In the joint, in every good work to do his will. Then goes on to say, working in you. What it means to say that you and I cannot do it on our own. Every good work that God desires to do, he must do it from the inside to affect the outside. Give the Lord a hand praise. Transformation resulting in an outward reformation.
Amen.
Listen, he says, Jacob says, O Lord, deliver me. I don't know if you've ever experienced the misery in being in a place you don't want to be.
All right.
I think it's nothing quite as nerve-wracking. Getting up on Monday, going to a job you hate.
Yeah.
Work with folks that don't care much about you at all. How long have you ever been in a relationship? It wasn't serving you emotionally at all. In fact, it was depriving you of the love you needed. The respect that you deserve. And yet, nothing can be quite as miserable as to be someplace you don't want to be. He says, deliver me. Take me out of this. And how did God answer him? Does God come down from heaven and cuddle Jacob and rock him and soothe his concerns and speak gently to him? No. The record said God met him in a fight. What kind of response is that? I'm asking God to rescue me. Bring me out of a place I don't want to be. To deliver me. And his answer is, we got to fight.
Yeah.
All right. I want to tell you something. Tell you something you may not want to, I don't know, embrace. But somebody to get out of where you are, you got to fight. They all need that. Listen, tell your neighbor,
if
you want out,
you're
going to have to fight.
Yeah.
Pharisees about their self-righteousness. And he'll confront you and me in order to bring us to a new place. Give the Lord a hand, bring it. You see, when God confronts us, you can get mad if you want to, you can get in denial if you want to, but he confronts us so that you and I can deal with some real issues. In fact, much of Jesus' ministry involved him confronting people in order to deliver them. And can I tell you, even the word of God is confrontational. So listen, you heard me say over here, if you and God can face it, then you and God can certainly fix it. Listen, Jacob prayed for deliverance. And now he is all alone, separated and isolated. And in the stillness of the night, God begins to deal with Jacob. Look at how God chose to deliver Jacob. Number one, he chose to deliver him. Deliverance comes through prayer. Deliver me, I pray. Yes. We pray the disciples' prayer that says, lead us not into temptation. But God, somewhere along the line, deliver me from evil. Some translations read, deliver me from the evil one. In other words, deliverance becomes a praying matter. Some of your greatest battles will be won on your knees. You see, Jacob recognized that he could not deliver himself. That whoever and whatever he had become had been so become so entangled in his nature, they didn't know how to get out of it. Deliver me. He recognized that his past was becoming a burden, and he said, deliver me. His own emotion now became one of a constant paranoia and depression. And so he says, deliver me. Apostle Paul tells us, 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 4, that the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. In other words, that who you're fighting against, you can't intimidate him with bullets and guns. Listen, brother, sister, you can't cuss the devil out so much he'll leave you alone. You can't talk about him so bad that he'll walk away. He said, so the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. That you can't use material things to fight the enemy we're fighting. But he goes on to say, first he tells us what they're not. They're not carnal. Then he tells us what they are. But they are mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations, and every high thing that exalts itself against what you know about God. Bringing into captivity even every thought to the obedience of Christ. In other words, he recognized that it's on my knees that the battle begins. Because the battle is not between, listen, me and the folk I'm walking around. But as Paul says, there's some other demonic influences. We wrestle not against just flesh and blood. He prayed with me. And so prayer is the beginning. And that's why sometimes the enemy keeps you so busy that when you're trying to pray, you find yourself nodding, your own snoring with you. He said, if I can just occupy every moment of that time, I can stop the prayer warriors from being effective. Give the Lord a hand, pray. God brought deliverance for Jacob through his struggle. The Bible says in that 24th verse, and Jacob was left alone, and there wrestled a man with him until the breaking of the day. You see, in our society, people tend to view struggling as a negative thing. But I want you to know something.